a woman can fight torture and oppression, if she can break a glass ceiling and advocate for equality and tolerance, if she can go door to door to combat domestic and child abuse, then surely we can summon a fraction of their bravery. Somebody's got to do it, and why shouldn't it be you?
A woman can make great impact in society. I realized that through leading the organization, I could support more than one individual. I could change the policies in the state. I can make a better life for those groups to whom I serve.
We face sexism, harassment, name and shame us. I hope that one day people will understand and recognize that our voice was for everyone.
The first film that you made while the Taliban was still in charge, and it sounds like making the film was as dangerous as the content.
Oftentimes, even when you walk in the street, people ask you, what happened to you? Why are you in a wheelchair? Once I tell them that I've been shot, they will say, what did you do to him?
This is my responsibility to be here, and you might be an example for other women that they are coming behind you. It is for many women that they watch me and say, okay, but she did it. Why we don't do it? We have to go for it too.
You've been after such suffering by being abducted, kept incommunicado, my family and friends believing that I might be dead. I still felt that I had a responsibility to go on doing human rights work.
The world will never, ever, ever reach its potential till all women are treated with dignity and respect.
Good morning. My name is Kat Fotovet, and I am the senior official for the Secretary's Office of Global Women's Issues here at the State Department. It is my pleasure to welcome both our in-person and virtual audience to the 15th annual Secretary of State's International Women of Courage Awards. We are delighted to join you today on International Women's Day. Since 2007, the U.S. has marked this day by recognizing women who have exemplified exceptional courage and leadership, advocating for human rights, women's equality, and social progress, often at great personal risk to themselves and their families. Our office is responsible for ensuring that gender equality and women's empowerment are integrated throughout the work of the State Department, both here in Washington and at our embassies and consulates overseas. We aim to ensure that women's issues are at the forefront of our foreign policy in every corner of the world by raising gender equality in conversations with other governments and listening to, learning from, and working with civil society activists to promote more fair and just societies. The International Women of Courage Award is a critical component of our work and an event we look forward to every year. The award selection process is extremely competitive, and our awardees should be very proud of this recognition. Each year, this ceremony draws greater interest and enthusiasm. And we want to build on this momentum moving forward in collaboration with all of you watching the ceremony today, both in the United States and all over the world. This event is also an opportunity for the United States to reaffirm its commitment to the advancement of gender equality and women's empowerment, and to recognize the unique contributions of women, and especially today's honorees. To this year's awardees, thank you so much for the work that you do to speak up for the voiceless, to protect the vulnerable, and to push governments to do a better job for their citizens. We recognize the risks that you are taking and celebrate your courage to persist. We hope that this recognition will help further advance your causes in your respective countries and on the international stage. We are so inspired by all of your stories, and while we recognize the challenges to the advancement of women's empowerment continue to persist, we also celebrate the enormous progress that has been made over the last few decades due to the efforts of women like our awardees. Now, it is my great and distinct honor to welcome to the stage the First Lady of the United States, Dr. Jill Biden, and the Secretary of State of the United States, Antony Blinken. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's celebration. We have a few special guests today because this is an event that always brings people together. And our most special guest is our wonderful First Lady, Dr. Jill Biden, a dear friend, a fierce champion for women and girls here at home and around the world. Welcome. I'm also particularly pleased to welcome our new ambassador to the United Nations, Linda Thomas Greenfield, who is already doing an outstanding job representing America's interests and values to the world. And another good friend of many years, Ambassador Kathy Russell, now helping shape our workforce as director of the White House Presidential Personnel Office, but who did amazing work here at the State Department as the head of the Office for Global Women's Issues under President Obama. Kathy, great to have you. Kat Fotovat, who is carrying forward that critical work today, we deeply appreciate it. Acting Assistant Secretary Matt Lusenhop from the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, which played a major role in making this award ceremony possible. And from the First Lady's Office, Ambassador Julissa Reneso, now the First Lady's Chief of Staff, and former Deputy Assistant Secretary of State Mala Adiga, now the First Lady's Policy Director. It's particularly wonderful to see State Department alumni serving in Dr. Biden's office. And it's another reminder of how our work at home and around the world is entwined. Of course, our most important guests today are our honorees, the 2021 Women of Courage. We wish they could join us in person today. But even via video, it's still a pleasure and an honor to celebrate these extraordinary women. For 15 years, the State Department has given the International Women of Courage Award to women around the world who have shown exceptional strength and leadership in advocating for peace, justice, human rights, and gender equality, often at great risk to themselves. The women we honor today have endured violence, death threats, imprisonment, and police harassment because of their work. Some have fled their homes. Some have fled their countries. They deserve our support and recognition. And they remind us of something we must never forget, that it is often women who lead the charge for human rights, democracy, and justice, including in places where women hold much less than half of the political, economic, and social power. And it's often women and girls who are the most vulnerable to human rights abuses. That's why the equal rights and dignity of women and girls is a foreign policy priority for the United States. When we design our foreign policy with the rights and needs of women and girls in mind, our policy is more effective, more humane, and more likely to make a lasting difference in people's lives. And when we support women, we can help foster change on a much broader scale, because it's often women doing the hard work to make that change happen. That's certainly the case with today's honorees. And so, without further ado, here are this year's Women of Courage. First, Maria Kalesnikava is a democracy activist in Belarus. Ahead of last year's presidential election, she mobilized women across the country to protest the rule of Alexander Lukashenko, Europe's last dictator. She's absent from the screen today because she's sitting in a Belarusian prison. The United States will continue to call for her unconditional release and for the release of all political prisoners in Belarus. Maximilian Ngo Embi is a human rights activist in Cameroon. She's worked to bring an end to years of violence between the government and separatists, and to hold security forces to account for abuses against civilians. Wang Yu is one of the most prominent human rights lawyers in China. She's represented cases involving abused children, ethnic minorities, women, and religious adherents, and her work has brought government pressure on her through today. We've not been in regular communication over the past 2 days. We're concerned because we know that she wanted to attend today's ceremony. We'll be following up and if necessary, speaking out on her case. Mayerlise Angarita has been instrumental in the implementation of the peace accord in Colombia. Her relentless engagement has brought government and civil society groups together to stop violence and narco-trafficking. Julianne Lusenge has led the fight against sexual and gender-based violence in the Democratic Republic of the Congo for more than 40 years, founding the country's leading NGO and helping achieve international agreements against sexual violence in war. Erica Aifan is a trial judge in Guatemala's high-risk criminal court. She regularly faces threats and harassment as she presides over high-profile corruption and war atrocity cases. Shore Bayat is a referee of international chess tournaments, and she was photographed at a competition in China last year without her hijab visible. There was an outcry in her home country of Iran. She sought refuge in the United Kingdom, and now she is a leading voice for women's rights in Iran. Phu Phu Long led the movement in Burma to preserve the independence of universities and protect the teaching of ethnic minority languages. Her NGO builds ties among young people across ethnic and religious groups. Ms. Khan Khatun is a 16-year-old from Nepal who survived an acid attack after rejecting a boy's advances. Thanks to her courageous activism, there are now stronger penalties for acid attacks and regulations on the sale of acids in Nepal. Zahra Muhammad Ahmed is a lawyer in Somalia who fights for survivors of sexual and gender-based violence, internally displaced people, and refugees returning home, some of the most vulnerable people in one of the most dangerous places in the world. Ranita Gnanarajah is a lawyer who defends minority Muslim and Tamil communities in Sri Lanka, fights for justice for victims of enforced disappearances and prisoners detained for years without charge. Sister Alicia Vacas Moro is a member of the missionary group the Comboni Sisters. She ran a medical clinic in Egypt, served a Bedouin community outside Jerusalem, and now coordinates 40 nuns across the Middle East, helping trafficking victims, refugees, and asylum seekers. Canan Gullu is a women's rights activist and president of the Turkish Federation of Women's Associations. Last year, she successfully organized against Turkey's withdrawal from the Istanbul Convention, a human rights treaty against domestic violence. Ana Rosario Contreras is the president of the Caracas Nurses Association in Venezuela. A prominent labor activist, she organizes nationwide protests and strikes for healthcare workers. We're also posthumously honoring a group of courageous women from Afghanistan who paid the ultimate sacrifice while working toward a better future for their country. Fatima Khalil, an official with the Afghanistan Independent Human Rights Commission, was killed by an IED on her way to her office. Mariam Nourzad was a midwife in a hospital in Kabul. When three gunmen attacked the maternity ward, she refused to leave her patient and was killed along with the patient and newborn. Freshta, daughter of Amir Muhammad, was a prison guard murdered by an unknown gunman while walking to a taxi on her way to work. Fatima Rajabi was an anti-narcotics police officer captured and killed by the Taliban. Malala Mawand was a reporter murdered by unknown gunmen in Jalalabad, part of a troubling increase in violence against journalists in Afghanistan. General Shamila Fro, the head of the gender unit in the National Directorate of Security. She was assassinated in an IED explosion targeting her vehicle. And Freshta Kohistani was a popular blogger and women's rights and democracy activist killed by unknown gunmen near her home in Kapisa province. They represent women and girls across Afghanistan who continue to press on in defense of their hard-won gains and in the face of high rates of violence against Afghan women. Finally, I want to mention a woman we honored in 2012, Samar Badawi of Saudi Arabia, who fought a long battle for legal freedom from her father and became a prominent advocate for women's voting rights. She's been in prison since 2018, along with other women's rights activists, and we join other nations in calling for their release. My deepest thanks to all of this year's International Women of Courage. You're making our world more just, stable, peaceful, and free. The United States is proud to be in your corner. There is no better way to mark International Women's Day than by celebrating you. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce our First Lady, Dr. Jill Biden.
Good morning, everybody. And thank you, Secretary Blinken, Tony, Ambassador Russell, Ambassador Thomas Greenfield. Joe and I have so much respect and admiration for each of you. And to the men and women of this department, we are so grateful for your work. In the past few years, our Foreign Service officers have seen how fragile and critical diplomacy can be. But the challenges our nation faced only inspired you to fight harder for democracy, universal rights, and the rule of law in all the places you serve. The President and Secretary Blinken are going to make sure that your faith is rewarded. And America will lead because you are forging the way. When we hear of the stories of the women we honor today, it's easy to think of them as mythical heroes or angels among us, perhaps touched by the gods or chosen for greatness. What else could explain such Herculean acts of fortitude and fearlessness? Yes, our awardees today are heroes, but they are also human. They want what we want: comfort, happiness, good meals with friends and family, memories that make them smile long after they're made. Some of these women have spent their lives fighting for their cause. Others are just starting out on a journey that they didn't ask for. Some were called to service, and some couldn't escape it. They are fighting for their own lives and for their children. They want to right the wrongs of the past, build a brighter future for everyone. They aren't immune to fear, no one is. But in the course of their ordinary lives, each woman made an extraordinary choice. You see, courage isn't really found. It doesn't conjure away our doubts. It's an intentional decision made. It's the prickle of each possible disaster running the length of your back, but standing to face the unknown anyway. It's knowing that your feet may falter and choosing to walk forward. It's hearing the chorus of voices that say that you are not enough, that you will not succeed, and following a single note of hope through the din. These women made an extraordinary choice to persist, to demand justice, to believe that despite the obstacles and fear that they faced, that there is a future worth fighting for. And we have a choice to make too. If we have learned anything in this year of sickness and sorrow, it's that we are all connected to one another. How one deadly breath can move through the world. Poverty and conflict, unrest and uncertainty, these aren't contained by borders. But we've seen how joy can spread too. with the music of balcony concerts bringing comfort to people across the world. We've seen calls for justice echoing through the streets of cities near and far. And we've seen how the things that connect all of us, our love for family and friends, our hope that we will be together soon, transcend language and distance. Diplomacy at its best is a recognition of this connection. That freedom for women in Afghanistan strengthens communities everywhere. That education in Burma creates opportunity far away. That fair elections in Belarus will bolster our own democracy too. That justice can only be justice if it's for all. Your fight is our fight, and your courage calls us to come together again and again and again. My husband understands that we can't do this alone. The United States will stand with you. We will make the choice to lead, to be bold, and to lift up women and girls everywhere who light our way. For 15 years, we have honored women around the world who have made the extraordinary choice to fight for something bigger than themselves. Today, we recommit to being worthy of that courage, to understanding that our lives are tied together in immeasurable and powerful ways. And by choosing every day to honor that connection, we will stand with you as we build a brighter future for us all. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Director of the White House Personnel Office and former Ambassador at Large for Global Women's Issues, Ambassador Catherine Russell.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. It's great to be back. Dr. Biden, it's hard to follow you. I've been following you my whole career, so it's only appropriate that I do it today as well. Secretary Blinken, Ambassador Thomas Greenfield, always wonderful to be with you. And my former colleagues here at the State Department, it's really wonderful to be back here. I love being at the State Department, and I'm really delighted to see you all today. I've always loved this event, and so did the colleagues across the building. Every seat was always filled, and even the gruffest Foreign Service officers came away moved by the stories that they heard here. We all felt so grateful to be in the presence of such amazing women. This is an event and an award well named because the women we're honoring today and the women who have been honored these past 15 years have shown courage in all its forms. They're young and old, they're lawyers, nurses, human rights advocates, and even nuns. They're warriors for justice and advocates for accountability. And every day they work so hard to make the lives of those around them fairer, safer, and more just. In the last year, we here in the United States have seen many faces of courage in our own country, nurses, doctors, and countless frontline workers. We've learned firsthand that courage isn't acting without fear, but acting despite it. Each of our awardees today has summoned courage, many in situations hard for us here to imagine. Several of them have lost their lives in those efforts. It's only right that we honor them here today, but it's not enough. All of us have to carry on the struggle for women's rights here and around the world. The awardees here today remind us how much that struggle means. And it's now my great pleasure to introduce video messages from the chiefs of mission representing the embassies that nominated this year's awardees.
Afghan women have shouldered enormous burdens and shown great valor over four decades of war. It's my honor today to speak about the lives of seven of them. They come from different professions and backgrounds. They have in common the bravery that impelled them to change their world and the sacrifice in so doing of their lives. These seven women are among many in Afghanistan whose sacrifice and courage inspires us all. We honor and remember them. Fatima Natasha Khalil was a widely loved officer with the Afghanistan Independent Human Rights Commission. At age 24, she was killed, along with her driver, in June 2020, when their car was destroyed by an IED in Kabul. Natasha was born a refugee in Pakistan, came with her family to Kabul, and later graduated from the American University of Central Asia in Bishkek. Fluent in six languages, she could have gone anywhere. Natasha Khalil came here to help her country. Sharmila Froh was one of the longest-serving female officers at the Afghan National Directorate of Security. Over the course of a 30-year career, she led its anti-kidnapping division, spent time undercover to combat criminal networks, and headed the Gender Diversity Department. In March 2020, General Froh was killed not far from the American Embassy in Kabul by an IED attached to her car. Mariam Nurzad was a devoted midwife who served remote locations in Wardak and Bamyan provinces before joining Maison Sans Frater at the Kabul PD 13 hospital. In May 2020, gunmen attacked its maternity ward, but Ms. Nurzad refused to leave her patient who was in labor. They and the newborn baby died in the delivery room among 24 others who lost their lives that day. Fatima Rajabi was a police officer. Originally from Ghazni province, she took up anti-narcotics duties in Kabul. At 23, and the sole breadwinner supporting her mother, brother, and younger sister, she was traveling to her home village in July 2020 when the Taliban took her captive and killed her. 2 weeks later, the Taliban sent Fatima Rajabi's remains to her family. Freshta, daughter of Amir Mohammed, was a 35-year-old employed by the Office of Prison Administration. On her way to work in October 2020, she was murdered by unknown gunmen. We have few details on her life. We do know that as one of the few women working as a guard in the Afghan prison system, Freshta demonstrated that Afghan women can do any job they wish. Malala Maywand was a well-known journalist at NCAS radio and television. Along with her driver, she was, at age 23, shot and killed by gunmen in Jalalabad in December 2020. The so-called Islamic State later claimed responsibility. Underscoring the challenge of being a female journalist in Afghanistan, she received many threats, but did not stop reporting and advocating on public affairs, women's rights, and other issues. She was strongly motivated. 5 years earlier, her mother, also an activist, was also killed by unknown gunmen. Freshta Kohistani was a prominent women's rights activist and blogger with over 46,000 social media followers. She persevered in spite of threats. She and her brother were assassinated by unknown gunmen near her home in Kapisa province in December. Freshta Koestani left behind a husband and a child. On behalf of the United States, I extend my deepest condolences to the families of these brave and distinguished women for their loss. We treasure the memories of Freshta Koestani, Malalai Maywand, Freshta, daughter of Amir Mohammed, Fatima Rajabi, Mariam Nurzad, General Sharmila Frokh, Natasha Khalil, and of course, many others. All of us mourn their loss and take inspiration from their lives of character, courage, and service to their people and their country. Thank you.
It is my great honor to introduce Maria Kalesnikava of the Republic of Belarus as one of the Secretary of State's 2021 International Women of Courage. After the regime excluded three leading opposition candidates from the presidential election last summer, the women of Belarus stepped in. Maria, the campaign manager for one of those candidates who was put in jail, served as the organizer and public voice of the candidacy of Svetlana Tsikhanouskaya, the wife of yet another imprisoned candidate. Veronika Tsepkala, the wife of the third candidate, who went into exile to avoid being arrested, also joined the effort. These three women became known as the Troika. All three deserve recognition as incredibly courageous leaders. Maria called on her fellow citizens to stand up for fundamental freedoms and civil liberties, while urging police and protesters alike to reject violence. At times, Maria put herself physically between the two to prevent violence. Inspired by Maria and her partners, women across Belarus responded to the power of her example and, in the face of horrific police brutality, rose up as leaders of the peaceful protest movement. Authorities abducted Maria, threatened to kill her, and tried to forcibly exile her. In response, Maria defiantly tore her passport at the border, risking her life and imprisonment on false charges to stay in Belarus and fight for freedom and democracy. Even from her prison cell, Maria's bravery continues to inspire the people of Belarus and all those around the world who cherish freedom. Maria, we salute you and we call once again for your immediate release.
I want to express my warmest congratulations to Pyo Pyo Aung for receiving the prestigious 2021 International Women of Courage Award. Pyo Pyo Aung is a fearless and lifelong human rights activist and former political prisoner. Of course, I am taping this message against the backdrop of an unlawful military coup that overthrew the democratically elected government of Burma. Pyo Pyo Aung's work has therefore become even more urgent. The courage and commitment shown by Pyo Pyo Aung and so many others in opposing the coup offer hope for a return to the promise of democracy in Burma at this dark time.
Hi everyone, my name is Pyo Pyo Aung. I'm a political activist from Burma. Currently, I'm working with diverse youth from the different areas of Burma to emerge reconciliation process for sustainable peaceful society.
Pyo Pyo Aung continues to work today as the director of the Wings Institute for Reconciliation, which creates dialogue and understanding between young people of different ethnic and religious backgrounds with the goal of building a more united, tolerant, and inclusive Burma. That goal and her efforts are more important than ever. For her work promoting peace building and reconciliation, vital to greater democratic freedoms for all, Pyo Pyo Aung is recognized as a 2021 International Women of Courage Awardee.
Greetings from Cameroon. My name is Vernell Trim Fitzpatrick, chargée d'affaires of the U.S. Embassy. It is my honor to introduce Maximilienne Chantal Ngo-Embe, the Executive Director of the Network of Human Rights Defenders of Central Africa. Maximilienne has faced a number of challenges. She has endured physical assault, attempted kidnappings of herself and of her children, arson, burglaries, and smear campaigns. Yet for 30 years, she has remained steadfast and her commitment to promoting the human rights and political freedoms of others. Maximilienne has fought against everything from detentions of journalists and political actors to abusive treatment of LGBTI people and overcrowding in prisons. Since the start of Cameroon's violent separatist conflict in 2016, with a high toll of civilian deaths and displacement, Maximilien has tirelessly called for a ceasefire and mediation process, advocated for humanitarian access, and shed light on civilian casualties. She's pressed for accountability of security forces in the context of separatist conflict and in the fight against Boko Haram and ISIS West Africa. When video circulated in 2015 of soldiers shooting two women and children in the far north, she was one of the leading voices insisting on accountability. Her tenacity helped lead to conviction of four soldiers in 2020, an example of Maximilien's perseverance in championing justice under the law and her ongoing contribution to Cameroon's democratic development. I've had the privilege to see firsthand the amazing work Maximilien is doing. Her commitment to fundamental rights and freedoms in Cameroon is inspiring to us all.
大家好，我是来自中国的人权律师，我叫王宇。我来自内蒙古，在北京做律师。因为代理人权案件，2015年开始受到打压，之前被关了一年多，又被软禁了一年多。我作为一个法律人，还是希望能够，推进中国的法治建设。也希望能够在中国这个社会上实现人权法治，也实现一个公平和正义吧。从我个人来说，因为2008年，我曾经被司法公检法迫害打击报复，而判刑2年半。之后呢，我2015年也因为代理人权案件，被政府打击报复。另外，我代理的案件过程中，我也看到这种司法的腐败和堕落。因此，作为一个法律人，我觉得我有义务来推进这个法治。所以我也是希望能有更多的人站出来，为中国这个法治和公平正义来呐喊吧。
I'm honored to introduce a courageous Colombian social leader, Mayerlis Angarita. She represents victims of Colombia's conflict and women leaders who raise their voices to defend others at great personal peril. 20 years ago, coping with the loss of her mother, Mayerlis gathered women to share personal tragedies, creating her organization, Narrar para Vivir, Narrate to Live. It's now 800 women strong. Mayerlis participated in Colombia's peace talks in 2016, securing women's rights in the peace accord. Today, despite continued death threats and the COVID pandemic, Mayerlis is a powerful advocate for her community and for the protection of women leaders nationwide. With each victory achieved by brave leaders like Mayerlis, Colombia grows stronger and takes a step away from violent conflict and toward lasting peace. Nothing makes us prouder than standing beside her, a woman of courage.
Si nacería y me preguntaran que si quería ser volver a ser defensora, no lo dudaría, porque la satisfacción que tú sientes cada vez que le entregan unos restos a unas mujeres o que capturan a uno de los victimarios que le hacen daño o que podemos superar esos duelos digamos postergados que teníamos por las acciones y cuando veo a las mujeres que están consumidas en un estado victimizante y luego de 1 o 2 años las veo como sujetas de derecho, empoderadas con sus negocios, con sus hijos, esa es la mejor satisfacción que puedes tener de servir.
I'm honored today to introduce Julianne Lusenge from the town of Beni in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. She is the DRC's leading activist in the fight against gender-based violence. For decades, Julianne has worked to promote the rights of women and girls in conflict situations. After witnessing the enormous toll that Eastern Congo's violence has had on women and girls, in 2000, she created the group Women's Solidarity for Peace and Integral Development. Despite numerous attempts on her life by armed groups, Julianne's social support program for local women provided holistic care and legal support for hundreds of victims of sexual violence each year and runs social programs that benefit around another 11,000 women and girls annually. Julianne's work has extended far beyond the DRC. Her advocacy in Africa, Europe, and the Americas has championed the rights of survivors. Her testimony and personal knowledge of the effects of gender-based violence were crucial to the drafting of international accords recognizing sexual violence as a weapon of war.
Je me dis, on peut pas arrêter, on doit continuer parce que nous savons qu'il faut un jour changer la situation des femmes, et c'est seulement nous qui changerons cette situation.
For her lifetime of work championing the rights of women and girls in conflict situations, Embassy Kinshasa, my team, is privileged and honored to present to you Julianne Lusenge as a 2021 International Woman of Courage.
Greetings from Guatemala. It is my honor to recognize the Department of State's 2021 International Woman of Courage awardee, Judge Erika Aifan. Sitting on the high-risk criminal court, Judge Aifan has responsibility for cases involving high-impact crimes as assigned by the Criminal Chamber of the Supreme Court of Guatemala. She's a member of the Association of Judges for Integrity and has set a powerful example of courage in Guatemalan society. She's presided over high-profile corruption and war atrocity cases, which have led to defamation and even threats of violence against her. Despite such daunting challenges, Judge Aifan has persisted as an effective and independent Guatemalan jurist. The United States government is very pleased to have this opportunity to recognize her determination, her fortitude, and her courage in upholding the rule of law in Guatemala.
El trabajo de los jueces en Guatemala, especialmente en los tribunales de alto riesgo, ayuda a proteger la seguridad de los actores involucrados en casos relacionados con delitos graves y de alto perfil. Nuestro sistema de justicia sigue presentando retos en su desarrollo. A pesar de la fuerte oposición que he enfrentado a lo largo de mi carrera, he procurado la lucha contra la corrupción y junto con otros jueces nos hemos esforzado por aumentar la transparencia y la independencia en el sistema de justicia guatemalteco. El reto es grande y estoy comprometida con la justicia, con mis compañeros jueces y con la sociedad guatemalteca. Muchas gracias.
Hi. I'm Yael Lempert, the chargé d'affaires at the United States Embassy in London. And I know everybody's been watching The Queen's Gambit. But today, it's my honor to highlight a real-life chess heroine and a winner of the International Women of Courage Award. Shore Bayat is a woman of not only incredible intellect and talent, she is also a woman of inspiring courage. Last year, when she left her home in Tehran and boarded a flight to Shanghai to referee the Women's Chess World Championship, Shore had no idea that she might never see her country again. Being part of that competition should have been a dream come true, a highlight in her already glittering chess career. But when Shore was photographed at the competition wearing her headscarf loose, an outcry followed. For many decades, the Iranian regime has dictated that all women must cover their heads and wear the hijab. The regime demanded a public apology from Shore. Instead, she took a stand. She was photographed again, this time with no hijab at all. And the world's media was set alight. Shore has used that spotlight to champion the rights of Iranian women and speak out against the fundamental freedoms that they are denied. Her courage has come at a cost. Fearing for her safety, she made the heart-wrenching decision to seek refuge in the United Kingdom. She is separated from her family back home. But Shore stands on the world stage now, a beacon of courage and a champion of change for women in Iran and for women everywhere.
Namaste. Muskan Khatun exemplifies strength, perseverance, courage, and the ability to affect change. In 2019, at the age of 14, Muskan was the victim of an acid attack after she rejected a boy's advances. She suffered severe burns on her face, chest, and hands. Her recovery was painful and continues to this day. Unlike other victims whose stories faded after a few days of headlines, Muskan chose to speak out. Despite threats and social pressure, she lobbied for national change. She went before a parliamentary committee and demanded stronger laws and punishments for these horrific attacks. And she met with the Prime Minister of Nepal. Only days after their meeting, the Prime Minister called for a new law to be drafted and issued an ordinance punishing the perpetrators of acid attacks and regulating the sale of chemicals used in these attacks. Muskan's leadership was crucial in bringing about that change. Just a few months later, the Nepali government went further to protect women and victims of gender-based violence by strengthening punishments for rapists and for the protection of victims. Although her attackers sought to take her smile, Muskan, whose name means smile in Nepali and Hindi, is still smiling. She transformed her tragedy into a force for change and an example for future women, girls, and other marginalized groups in Nepal. So thank you, Muskan, and congratulations on receiving this prestigious award and for making a difference in Nepal and in the world.
Meet Zara Mohammed Ahmed, or Mama Zara, as she is fondly known to those around her. She is a beacon of hope for Somali women and girls, and for everyone working for human rights in a part of Africa that has long suffered from conflict. Mama Zara's organization in Mogadishu is the Somali Women Development Center. The aim is to support women and girls by providing access to justice and fostering greater social and economic independence. The center works at the grassroots level, operating one-stop centers to provide medical and legal assistance to women and girls victimized by sexual and gender-based violence. Mama Zara's talented team also supports other vulnerable groups, internally displaced persons and refugee returnees, in some of Somalia's toughest areas. Operating in Somalia comes at great cost. Mama Zara lost her only son in a senseless killing. Her colleagues routinely receive death threats, and some have been killed. Even with those tragic losses and this terrible risk, Mama Zara fights every day for Somali women and girls, demonstrating courage and passion that few can match.
The U.S. Embassy to the Holy See is proud that Sister Alicia Vacas Moro was selected as an International Woman of Courage. Born in Spain, Sister Alicia joined the Catholic Order of the Comboni Sisters to dedicate her life to God and to others. Sister Alicia has shown exceptional courage and leadership, advocating for marginalized populations in the Middle East for more than 20 years. She is also a registered nurse and a human rights advocate who empowers women, educates children, and provides medical care in predominantly Muslim communities. From her work in a rural healthcare clinic in Egypt to her tireless efforts to improve the lives of Bedouin women and children, and to helping refugees fleeing war and political instability, Sister Alicia has taken exceptional risks to ensure the rights and dignity of others. When the COVID-19 pandemic struck Northern Italy, Sister Alicia again showed her selfless commitment to others. Undeterred by the danger of the coronavirus, she went to provide medical care at her convent in Bergamo. Tragically, 10 of her 55 sisters would fall victim to the coronavirus within weeks. Sister Alicia's valor, generosity, and leadership, virtues that exemplify a woman of courage, are truly inspirational.
I'm thrilled to introduce Renita Gnanarajah as a finalist for the Secretary of State's 15th Annual International Women of Courage Award. Ms. Gnanarajah is a lawyer who fights on behalf of Sri Lanka's most vulnerable populations, including families affected by enforced disappearances, survivors of gender-based violence, and religious and ethnic minorities. She's dedicated her life to the pursuit of justice, often at considerable personal risk. Some of her most impressive work involves advocacy for families of the disappeared and for prisoners arrested under Sri Lanka's Prevention of Terrorism Act, who are often detained for years without charges. Ms. Gnanarajah has also worked tirelessly to build the capacity of grassroots organizations that advocate for women's equal rights to land and property and to stand against gender-based violence. Among her many accomplishments, I am most inspired by her leadership and advocacy for a victim-centered approach for inquiries into enforced disappearances stemming from Sri Lanka's 30-year civil war. A tireless advocate for women, Ms. Gnanarajah's important domestic violence research identified deficiencies at police stations that impeded women's ability to seek protection from abuse and harassment. Her representation of survivors in court and her leadership of awareness campaigns to educate women about their rights resulted in increased access to women's shelters, counseling services, and medical care for domestic violence survivors across the country. Ms. Gnanarajah has helped the most vulnerable people avail themselves of their rights, and in doing so, is a model of courage in Sri Lanka and around the world. I'm proud to nominate her for the International Women of Courage Award.
On behalf of the United States mission to Turkey, I'm pleased to introduce activist and president of the Turkish Federation of Women's Associations, Canan Gullu, as a recipient of the 2021 International Women of Courage Award. This award is in recognition of her lifelong commitment to promoting women's equality and combating gender-based violence. Ms. Gullu's advocacy shines a spotlight on the need for more effective measures to combat gender-based violence in line with Turkey's domestic and international obligations. Particularly during this pandemic, we are grateful for Ms. Gullu's work to provide services to the vulnerable who are isolated at home. She reminds all women of Turkey that they are not alone, and her concrete actions support her kind-hearted words. Thank you, Ms. Gullu, for exemplifying exceptional courage and leadership in advocating for human rights, women's equality, and social progress. You are a true woman of courage, and today we congratulate you on your achievements.
From the Venezuela Affairs Unit in Bogota, Colombia, we were thrilled to nominate Ana Rosario Contreras, president of the Caracas Nurses Association, and elated she was selected as a recipient of the Secretary of State's 2021 International Women of Courage Award. As Venezuela confronts a deepening economic, political, and humanitarian crisis compounded by the repressive tactics of a dictatorial regime, Ana Rosario is a striking example of the many courageous Venezuelan women fighting for a better future. Her advocacy for the rights of women, labor unions, medical health professionals, and patients, all the more vital as we face a global pandemic, is truly inspiring and worthy of recognition. We applaud you, Ana Rosario, for the work you have done and continue to do for a free and democratic Venezuela that champions the rule of law and human rights.
A pesar del hostigamiento, la persecución por parte de los cuerpos represivos del Estado venezolano, del hostigamiento laboral, la enfermera venezolana sigue en la calle. Y seguimos en la calle porque estamos convencidos que el coraje, la valentía y el compromiso es un elemento esencial para devolverle al país la libertad y la democracia, donde tengamos plena vigencia de los derechos humanos y podamos ver crecer a nuestros hijos como hombres y mujeres prósperos en la mejor Venezuela. Y lo más importante, seguimos empoderando el nombre de la mujer venezolana.
You are all truly inspiring, and it is a privilege to be with you today to celebrate your leadership, your bravery, and your dedication. Each of you has done so much to improve the lives of your communities, your countries, and the world around you. Every year, I am in awe of the amazing women who are nominated and selected for this award. As we mark the 15th anniversary, I'm so honored to be part of the IWOC sisterhood. From a small seed of an idea in 2007 to the globe-spanning network of nearly 200 women who have received this honor to date, these awards have been transformative for everyone involved. Our shared commitment
to using platforms such as IWOC to promote women's empowerment represents the best aspirations and highest ideals of American leadership in foreign policy. Congratulations to the Office of Global Women's Issues and the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs for continuing to take this program to new heights year after year. And again, congratulations to all of the amazing recipients this year and in years past. Thank you.
I'm delighted to be able to bring greetings on the occasion of the 15th anniversary of the International Women of Courage Awards. And I want to reach out and extend my congratulations to this year's awardees, all 15 of you, on this very special occasion. I have been privileged as ambassador for women in the 4 years that I was at the State Department to be able to participate in the award ceremony, and most especially to get to know the awardees individually. Women like you who are on the front lines of change all over the world, doing absolutely remarkable things, often at great risk to them and to their families. So many women, so many like you, who are doing that hard work around the world. And we all benefit greatly from what you do, because you are working each and every day in your communities, in your countries, and for our world to make it a better place. So I congratulate each and every one of you, and I want to say happy anniversary to the International Women of Courage Award.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the representative of the United States of America to the United Nations, Ambassador Linda Thomas Greenfield.
Good morning. I'm so inspired by what I just heard, the descriptions of all of these wonderful women. I'm almost speechless. I don't know that there's anything more to say other than thank you. Thank you, Secretary Blinken, for inviting me today and honoring all of us here to come to the State Department and hosting this extraordinary event. And I'm especially thankful to Dr. Biden for joining us here and honoring us with your presence. I'm in awe of the heroines we are celebrating today. Seeing your bravery, hearing about your strength, it's beyond inspiring. You have organized mass protests and protected vital human rights, and you stood up to autocrats and authoritarians who, I might add, seem to be mostly men. Sorry, Tony. Perhaps most important of all, you have shared your stories with the world, often at great personal risk to your lives. That is a tremendous service, because your courage is contagious. I have no doubt that each of you has inspired other women to organize, demand equity, break down barriers to a stronger, more secure, and more peaceful world. I know this is true because women like you, on the front lines of humanitarian work, peace building, and equal rights advocacy across the globe, have inspired me throughout my career. You are why I made peace and security a focal point of our work at the United Nations this week. On my very first day as ambassador, I met with women working on the ground in Yemen to address one of the world's worst humanitarian disasters. The WHO estimates that 2 million children under the age of 5 are at risk of starvation and acute malnutrition as a result of years of conflict. Women are on the front lines of this urgent humanitarian crisis and so many conflicts around the world. And that's why, during my presidency of the UN Security Council this month, I'm bringing the voices of women experts into our council meetings, wherever possible, to ensure that women's voices are valued and are heard at the United Nations. After all, women make the world more peaceful. That is not just anecdotal. It's a fact. I lived and worked in Liberia for 4 years, and I saw the amazing work that women were able to do there to bring peace. And by promoting women's participation and leadership in politics, in mediation, and in negotiations, we promote more security and more peace. Yet women continue to face enormous barriers to representation and leadership, particularly the threat of violence. The seven Afghan women we honor today are a devastating testament to the violence perpetrated against women across the globe, simply for speaking up and contributing to a stronger, safer world. The violence is meant to silence, and we cannot allow that to happen. We must address it head on. We must ensure that their voices continue to be heard. And that's why it's so important that today and every day, we continue to spotlight their work. We must continue to show the world how much it means when you insist on your presence or persist for equity and for justice. In closing, I want to thank you for your bravery. I want to thank you for your resolve. I want to thank you for your resistance and your resilience, and for all that each of you are doing each and every day to work to make the world more equal and more peaceful and a place that we can leave to our children. Congratulations to all of you, and thank you for your service.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Acting Assistant Secretary for the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, Matthew Lusenhop.
Thank you. Greetings and happy International Women's Day. Thanks for joining us from across the world. My name is Matt Lusenhop, and I'm the Acting Assistant Secretary of the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs, known as ECA. To First Lady Dr. Biden, Secretary Blinken, Ambassador Linda Thomas Greenfield, Ambassador Russell, and the Office of Global Women's Issues, thanks for your leadership and your support of these incredible international women of courage. For 15 years, our tradition is that each year's group of international women of courage not only receive this prestigious award from the Secretary and the First Lady, they also participate in an ECA exchange called the International Visitor Leadership Program, or IVLP for short. In a typical year, the IVLP brings over 5,000 current and emerging leaders to the United States, joining a group of over 225,000 alumni since the program began more than 80 years ago. And the IVLP is as important today as ever to connect American and foreign participants. And we're proud to have pivoted to a virtual model during this pandemic. The International Women of Courage will soon join their IVLP virtual programs, meeting with American counterparts to share knowledge on global health, civic engagement, and the protection of human rights. This program is not only beneficial to our international visitors, but it also enriches our local American communities who host them and helps build global networks of activists and organizers. So to the awardees, as you prepare for your virtual exchange, please know the American people share your vision of positive change, and we support your continued efforts. Please stay in contact with the Americans from your programs that you meet, and I'm looking forward to hearing about the impact that you will have on U.S. communities that you meet. Thank you to all who joined from around the world for this celebration of the 2021 International Women of Courage. We extend our heartfelt congratulations to all of the awardees and our best wishes as they continue on their virtual journeys across America. And now, to conclude today's ceremony, let's see our wonderful International Women of Courage 2021 awardees one more time. Thank you.